of these steps, we tried to carry this message to alcoholics and to practice these principles in all our affairs. Now, I've had a couple of people that I've consulted. You know, I go over to steps with other people who are, I don't know, people who are trying to figure it out. That's all. I don't want to say intellectuals, but I want to say people who are trying to figure out what the hell was going on here. How do I implement these steps into my life? And if you'll read into the step 12, one of the guys that I've come across that I you know talk to says, if you'll read this step, it says that you don't start helping people through the 12 steps until you've had this spiritual awakening. And it does say, having had a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, we tried to carry this message to alcoholics and practice these principles in all our affairs. And my argument was that you're supposing here that you've now had a measurable spiritual awakening, that you can actually say that there was a time and a day that I can say that I actually transformed. My life went from the old life to the new life, and I now have a spiritual awakening as a result. There was a day that I could measure and say that that was the day that I had a spiritual awakening. And that at that point, I was capable of taking others through the 12 steps, because at that point, I could explain to them how to have a spiritual awakening as they would understand, you know, coming to their God. But my argument on the side is that, number one, let's look at the history of AA. And that was that Ebby Thatcher was, if you go back to Bill's story, Ebby Thatcher was one of Bill Wilson's childhood friends, as he puts it, boyhood friends, I think, childhood, something like that. But Ebby Thatcher had come from the Oxford groups, instructed by them to help other people, and Ebby said, I know just the guy to go help. I'm going to go see Bill. So he goes over and he sees Bill Wilson, and he explains the steps to Bill, and Bill gets sober and never has another drink as long as he lives, but Ebby Thatcher goes out and drinks. You see what I'm saying? Is that the idea that you have to wait to have a spiritual awakening in order to help other people have a spiritual awakening is not true. Because whether or not someone's going to have a spiritual awakening isn't really contingent on whether I've had one or not. And it can easily be seen in that story of Bill and Ebby, that Ebby then came back and Bill sponsored him and Ebby never drank again. So sponsor becomes sponsee in a story like that. So when you're reading this, you're saying, this, okay, so having had a spiritual awakening as a result of these steps, that is when we try to carry the message to alcoholics and to practice these steps in all of our affairs. And my argument, like I said, was that at no point can I look back on my sobriety and say there was a specific day that I believe that I had a spiritual awakening. It's somewhat been a gradual awakening, and it's been, you know, more and more as years go on. And there was no point in the last 20 years that I've been sober have I actually said, you know, that was the day. I can tell you the day I stopped drinking was August 17th, 1990, because it's on my arrest sheet where I had to get it out to go get my expungement and all that stuff. And I had to, oh, there's my sobriety date. And, you know, that's the last day I got arrested. So that was not the day that I had a spiritual awakening. It was a gradually, you know, like they said, it was a mustard seed, and the mustard seed becomes this huge tree later on. It's almost something you can't even see. And then, there was no point in which I could actually say that I could measure it and say that was the day that. So here's the dilemma: is everybody saying, well, you know, I shouldn't really be helping other people through the 12 steps because I really don't feel like I've had a spiritual awakening. Therefore, I can't. If I haven't had this experience, how am I going to help somebody else have one? You know, I can't explain something to them that I haven't. Don't even know if I've had myself. But that puts you in a dilemma of you can't stay sober unless you help other people. And now you're saying you can't help other people because you're not sober. You haven't had this spiritual awakening, sort of a catch-22 in which you can't do this until you do that, and you can't do that until you do this. So that's my opinion on that, is start helping other people right out of the gate as soon as you can. If you got three steps and you understand the first three steps, you can help somebody get along that far. If you're out on step 6 or 8 or 9 or whatever it is you feel you're at, then that's how far that you think that you can help other people get to. And the idea of the spiritual awakening that they're talking of, what is the nature of this spiritual awakening can be easily be seen by simply going back over the steps and saying, well, first of all, you know, like in step 1, I am not God. It says, first of all, we had to quit playing God. And this is in the third step, like the next page we get over here. First of all, this is the how and why of it. First of all, we had to quit playing God. And that's the idea behind step 1, is complete ego deflation. And upon a completely devastated person, a completely deflated ego, we can build a new person, someone who's willing to completely invert their way of life, in which they were once a selfish, self-centered person who thought little of others, and can now be a giving and caring person and live a life of sacrifice for others, in which I completely, what did it, one description says, a set of principles that once the guiding forces of someone's life, I've now been completely cast aside for a whole new set of principles and guiding forces to guide them in their life. And that is, you know, the idea of selfishness. So when we're reading these third step pages here, we're going to be looking for selfishness and self-centeredness as being the root cause of our alcoholism, and the exact opposite of that, service and self-sacrifice for others as being the spiritual solution. And that's why we're back in Bill's story where he said, I ruthlessly face my sins. We don't deal with sin in AA. And nowhere in this book will you see anything like, you know, some of the stuff you see in the 12 and 12, like the 12 horsemen of the bewilderment and fear and whatever that is. And they got the 11-step.